Hi, everyone.
My name is Juliana Bita-Danube. I teach in the Philosophy Department here. And on behalf of the Philosophy Department, it is my great pleasure to welcome you for our second Kant lecture this week with R.J. Wallace. So Lanier has already introduced Jay and the Kant lectures yesterday, making my job today quite easy. But for those of you who weren't here, and also to celebrate again things worth celebrating, let me share just a couple of highlights from yesterday. So this lecture is the 42nd in a series of prestigious Kant lectures, which can be on any important topic we found out yesterday, related to Kant or not. The last few speakers were Elisabeth Anderson, Sam Scheffler, Anthony Appiah, Susan Wolf, Sally Aslinger. So we've been deeply fortunate. And the lectures are funded by the Elisabeth Rankin Crossett Fund. And we are equally privileged this year with R.J. Wallace. And Jay needs no introduction, which is an odd thing to say when I'm about to introduce him for the second time in a row. But Jay is a distinguished professor in the Department of Philosophy at the University of California, Berkeley. Jay is a big thinker who tackles some of the most central issues in moral philosophy, and whose interest extends into a variety of connected areas like political philosophy, philosophy of action, and philosophy of law. He has written on regret, love, anger, resentment, promising, among many other topics. And his recent book, The Moral Nexus, published in 2019, studies the relational structure of the moral domain. Like in his lecture last night, Jay offers a deeply relational understanding of reactive attitudes and obligations. I personally find this work incredibly powerful and insightful. And also, I know you shouldn't judge a book by its cover, but I really love the cover of that book. Although I'm not a moral philosopher myself, I have really enjoyed engaging with Jay's work over the years, in part indirectly through the work of many of my friends and colleagues on Promising and Regret. I have seen the influence Jay's work has had on a generation of terrific thinkers, thinking hard, for instance, about what it means to regret an act you now have reasons to value and applying them to eminently political questions. I'm thinking of Odette Naumann, for instance. On a recent visit to Berkeley, it also became clear to me how valued and kind a colleague Jay was to all around him. We couldn't be luckier to have gotten him to join us for a week of inspiring philosophy together. Last but not least, let me say something about yesterday's lecture as an intro to today's. Yesterday's talk was titled Resentment and Social Friction. It was a powerful lecture on the oppositional nature of reactive blame. Through a careful study of the phenomenon, Jay walked us through what he takes to be the most promising explanation of what we do when we blame, going through the importantly connected attitudes of resentment and anger. To blame, for Jay, is to respond to the wrongful conduct, hold others to normative demands, insist on one's interest being recognized as being as equally significant to those of others, and it is also to attempt to repair what is valuable about the relationship. Reactive blame has a deeply relational structure and is, in a way, in the service of the defense of morality in the face of violation. Against accounts, we would treat anger or resentment as something necessarily problematic, something that gets in the way, something we should want to see disappear. He sees it as an important part of what it means to value relationships and our moral obligations to others. I found all of this interesting, especially as a political philosopher and as a mother. As a parent of a two-year-old going through a tantrum phase, I spent the lecture wondering what exactly about my son's resentment is holding me to account for what, and what kind of repair he's hoping for. I'm told tantrums are age appropriate for a two-year-old, which I think is a very sweet way of suggesting that this would be totally inappropriate at any other age to be resentful for the kinds of things a two-year-old gets angry about. But I found it interesting to think about reactive blame as a kind of relationship building exercise, as a way to figure out together what the relationship is supposed to be about. Given that the relationship is valuable, but that we may slightly disagree about what makes it valuable. My son seems to think being a in a child-parent relation requires us doing everything he wants, whether it is extremely burdensome or dangerous. We insist that this is not what the relationship ought to be about. Later in life, blame often continues to be unfitting in this way in a relationship. But it is a good way to get clear on what it is that we think the relationship is supposed to be about. As a political philosopher, I found it interesting that Jay rejected the destructive interpretation of blame as a paradigmatic case of withdrawal from a relationship after an impairment. Jay believes that it is precisely because the relationship is valuable that we feel this anger and resentment. And so blame is a first step to repair seems more paradigmatic. As someone who is currently interested in demonization and stigmatization, I take this point to be very powerful. In a way, what we do when we demonize individuals who have done something wrong is that we often close the door to a form of rehabilitation or repair. But by doing that, we undermine the significance of the relationship that we stood in the first place. That seems self-defeating. We can instead blame, hold accountable, and seek to repair rather than ostracize or excluding. So tonight we continue our conversation with Jay on the politics of grievance, and I couldn't be more excited to hear Jay. Don't forget the discussion seminar tomorrow in room 1992Q at 3:30 p.m. And please join me in welcoming Jay for his second lecture.
Thank you very much, Juliana, for that very generous second introduction and that beautiful summary of my lecture yesterday. I've led me to feel like you should deliver my lecture today for me as well, but I think I'll just go ahead and do it myself. Before I get any further, I think this I'd like to just take an opportunity to thank Linda Fagan for terrific support of these events. She's just been amazing, and you're incredibly lucky to have her running things in the department. In yesterday's lecture, I argued that reactive blame could be understood as a source of social power. Angry disapprobation is inherently aversive in virtue of our susceptibility to the attitudes of others, as well as the affective and behavioral profile of the reactive emotions. This opens up the possibility, through exertions of expressive and managerial agency, of influencing the conduct of other people, subjecting them to pressures that incentivize them to act in accordance with our wishes. There's a large and difficult question about how the social power latent in our accountability practices can be reconciled with the ambition to recognize the standing of others as equal members of the moral community. Wherever it is present, social power can be abused to oppress and exploit and humiliate those at whom it's targeted. And this is as true of reactive blame as of more overt capacities to influence the behavior and attitudes of others. There's an understandable tendency to think that we'd be better off without emotional formations that can be abused in these ways, and that we should therefore strive to replace reactive blame with less fraught systems of response to moral infractions. I don't think this is a realistic aspiration. Human social life is shot through with the kinds of emotional dependencies and vulnerabilities that render us susceptible to the influence of others. Reactive attitudes may be unusual in being original sources of social friction, but they're not unusual in being potential sources of emotional influence over others. Moreover, when it comes to reactive blame, the very oppositional features of it that generate anxiety are connected to its value within social relations structured through directed obligations and claims. It reflects an ongoing commitment to the importance of a relationship that's been impaired through the disregard of moral claims, and its affective and dispositional profile point toward a communicative process that functions to repair the relations that have been damaged through the infraction. Having said that, I also think it's important for a defense of reactive blame to acknowledge and understand the distinctive interpersonal hazards that are latent in the social power that it brings in its train. That's going to be my aim in today's talk. If we hope to realize a system of truly egalitarian accountability relations between individuals, we need to start by identifying and diagnosing some of the important obstacles that stand in the way of that goal. So that brings me to the first section of the talk, Pathologies of Narcissistic Reaction. The pathologies I wish to discuss in this lecture are problematic expressions of reactive blame, especially cases that attract specifically moral objections. I begin with some pathologies of reaction in which the problematic dimensions of reactive blame lie on the side of the subject of reactive attitudes. I have to say, I think this is a beautiful lecture theater, but I'm slightly unnerved to be standing next to a gigantic window that's no doubt opening onto really interesting activities on the lawn involving students, but it's an interesting situation. And in thinking about pathologies of blame, it will be useful to begin with a paradigm of constructive blame that we can take as a point of reference and a standard of assessment. For this purpose, the case of communicative blame oriented toward repair naturally suggests itself. This is the paradigm discussed in the first lecture, in which reactive blame is discursively addressed to the person it targets and in a way that invites engagement about the grievance that it expresses. I characterize this kind of interaction as the communicative context in which reactive blame has a valuable interpersonal function and also an interaction to which the behavioral profile of the reactive attitudes naturally disposes us. Reactive blame is essentially about the flouting of a directed requirement, and this is a relational deficiency that needs to be acknowledged and addressed before the parties to it can move forward. Reactive blame, when discursively expressed, fits into a process of repair that is an important resource for individuals whose social relations are structured in terms of a system of directed requirements. Reactive blame seems in good order when it belongs to a process of this kind, or at least is suited to initiate such a process. And it's pathological, by the same token, when it has features that preclude its incorporation into a communicative exchange that is oriented toward acknowledgement and repair. Now, one familiar class of cases in which reactive blame falls short of this standard involves manipulation. Consider the choleric boss who's constantly flying off the handle at subordinates and coworkers, yelling at them at the slightest provocation, throwing plates with unfinished hamburgers on them against the wall when things don't go as they might wish, and so on. There's a performative aspect to these expressions of anger on the part of the subject, a strategic deployment of reactive anger that consciously or subconsciously aims at reinforcing hierarchy and bending the social will to the subject's, the social world to the subject's will. The social power that is latent in reactive blame is used strategically in these cases. Its social frictions are mobilized in order to manipulate others into displays of deference or efforts to assuage the angry subject's sense of vulnerability and hurt. Anger that takes this form is clearly not in good order, judged by reference to our communicative paradigm. For one thing, it's not in general about a genuine grievance that it would so much as be possible for the target individual to address. In a typical case of choleric manipulation, the real problem may be something in the subject's own comportment. Perhaps they purloined some classified documents when relocating from the White House to their private residence, or maybe they failed to anticipate a new threat to the family media empire they preside over. Call it Waystar Royco. But they act as if they're in trouble as a result of lapses on the part of their subordinates, lashing out at those individuals for having failed to avert the predicament that they now find themselves in. Under these circumstances, there's no way for reactive blame to be taken up in a communicative process of acknowledgement and repair, because there's no real infraction on the part of the target that genuinely needs to be addressed. The aim of this pathology of reaction lies elsewhere, in the shifting of blame from the subject onto someone else, or in the sour satisfaction that the subject might derive from a demonstration of their capacity to compel subservient behavior from their subordinates or their children. Cases of this kind involving manipulation and dominance are familiar to all of us, and they clearly mobilize the power dimension that's endemic to reactive blame. From a theoretical standpoint, however, they're not especially interesting. The deficiencies they involve relative to the ideal of a communicative process oriented to repair are too obvious to require much analysis. It's otherwise, I think, with the pathology of reactive blame that's become ubiquitous and, a ubiquitous and pernicious theme in contemporary political relations. This is the politics of resentment and grievance, as we might call it. By this, I have in mind the noteworthy fact that many citizens in contemporary democracies approach politics in a state of perpetual agitation. They're primed for anger and constitutionally susceptible to demagoguery that aims to get them riled up about things. Familiar sites for this tendency are the Trump rally and the Fox News evening program, but it's a much more widespread phenomenon. It's a ubiquitous feature of social media, for instance, whose algorithms famously promote content that's engaging, much of which turns out to be material that incites people to anger. People apparently respond to this stuff, taking satisfaction in being made to feel indignant or resentful, and seeking out interactions that reliably generate these sentiments in them. The propensities I've just summarized are well-known features of contemporary democratic cultures, but they're also pretty puzzling. If I'm right in suggesting that we're primed for anger and prone to take satisfaction in interactions that provoke in us this reaction, it seems to me that there has to be an antecedent psychic need that anger tends to speak to. Some drive or instinct or deficiency must be latent in our psychology, which leads us, for instance, to be engaged by social media content that makes us feel angry towards someone. To make sense of the politics of grievance, then, we have to answer two questions. First, what is the antecedent need that is satisfied by anger, leading us to seek out and be engaged by this way of relating to other people? And second, how does anger meet this need? Thinking about this contemporary phenomenon, it's natural to recall Nietzsche's discussion in the first essay of On the Genealogy of Morals about the emergence of modern moral consciousness in what Nietzsche refers to as the slave revolt. Here, for instance, is a short passage from my Berkeley colleague Mark Danner's account of one of the Trump rallies he wrote about in 2020 for the New York Review of Books. Quote, "The dynamic playing out before me was ancient. Already Nietzsche was calling it ressentiment, and had he been transported to Freeland, Michigan, the German philologist would have recognized instantly what he was seeing enacted before him, a kind of mummer's revolt of the powerless. Trump, the tribune of the powerless, the unmasker of the powerful, the denouncer, the insulter, the despoiler of idols, Trump was their imaginary revenge. He was the artist of grievance." End quote. The echoes of Nietzsche in our modern populist politics of resentment are indeed striking, but they're not just on the surface. A closer look at Nietzsche's analysis of the slave revolt can, I think, shed light on the two questions I've posed about the psychic need that is satisfied through encounters that stoke in us feelings of resentment and anger. So Nietzsche's story about the slave revolt begins with an emotional orientation that he attributes to the powerless masses in aristocratic pre-Christian European societies, that of ressentiment. I take this sentiment to be akin to envy, a hostile attitude that is felt by the powerless toward those who enjoy the advantages that are systematically denied to themselves. Nietzsche suggests that this antagonistic orientation grows to monstrous proportions in the psyches of the dispossessed masses until it becomes creative and gives birth to a new table of values. How exactly this process is to be understood is, of course, a matter of considerable scholarly controversy. But the reading I favor emphasizes the intelligibility deficit that characterizes the outlook of the enslaved masses prior to the creation of a new table of values. They are consumed with hatred and antagonism toward those in their community who occupy positions of aristocratic power and privilege. And yet these very individuals are held up as paragons of virtue and goodness by the prevailing scheme of values. They are proud, confident, magnanimous, and aware of their natural superiority. If these are understood to be admirable traits, however, then it hardly makes sense that the hatred of the masses should be focused so relentlessly on the nobility, since they are the very individuals who possess the virtues in the greatest degree. Prior to the slave revolt, then, the dispossessed masses are consumed by an antagonistic emotional orientation toward the aristocratic elite that is inscrutable in terms of the prevailing table of values. This is the intelligibility deficit to which I referred, and it can be understood as an emotional need on the part of the subjects of Nietzsche and Ressentiment. The creative moment of the slave revolt, and this is a very compressed summary of an interpretation of it that I've favored and have written about, but the creative moment on my reading of it should be understood against the background of this intelligibility deficit. What happens, I think, is that the dispossessed masses come to accept a new table of values because it satisfies their need to make sense of their emotional outlook. The new values enable them to see the aristocrats not as paragons of virtue, but as vicious and even evil. Their magnanimity and sense of superiority become the vice of pride, their self-sufficiency a form of callousness, and their willingness to assert themselves a haughty indifference to the interests of others. Interpreting the social world in these terms renders intelligible for the first time the all-consuming emotional orientation of the powerless. Who better to despise than individuals who are morally reprehensible to their core? This reading of the slave revolt situates it primarily within the psychic space of the dispossessed masses and their ressentiment toward the elite. The invention of the new table of values solves an emotional problem for these individuals, and that is where its real significance lies. Of course, Nietzsche himself emphasizes the genuine or intended effects of the slave revolt on the aristocratic elites, characterizing it as an act of spiritual revenge. But I don't think we can understand the strategic aspect of the process to characterize the outlook of the individuals in whom the revolt takes place. A new table of values will be created only if those individuals themselves sincerely come to accept them. And sincere acceptance seems difficult to reconcile with the cynical goal of exacting strategic revenge on the elite. The main locus for strategic thinking in this process, on my interpretation of it, is in the role of the priestly aristocracy in fomenting the revolt. The priests understand the psychic need that renders the masses susceptible to the new evaluative categories, and they propagate the new table of values in a deliberate attempt to create cultural conditions that will eventually lead to the demise of the natural aristocracy. When it comes to the contemporary politics of resentment, there is, of course, a clear analog to Nietzsche's cynical priests in the populist demagogues who are masters at exploiting the psychic needs of their audience. These needs, on my reading of the situation, are also remarkably similar to the conditions that drive Nietzsche's slave revolt. They consist primarily in an intelligibility deficit that is linked to a prior orientation of hostility or antagonism toward the other. This orientation can have multiple sources in the conditions of contemporary life. For the primarily rural and less educationally credentialed populations that seem to be particularly susceptible to right-wing demagoguery across many contemporary political cultures in Europe and North America, there may be factors at work that are very like the situation that gave rise to Nietzschean ressentiment in his account of the slave revolt. Declining economic and demographic prospects naturally give rise to something like envy of the urbanized coastal elite who have profited from the economic prospects opened up by the globalized economy, and whose preferences and tastes have come to dominate the popular culture that we all operate within. This is territory that has been extensively studied and reflected on in recent years, in countless reports by journalists from Heartland Diners, in the analysis of American deaths of despair by economists Anne Case and Angus Deaton, in the sociologist Arlie Hochschild's empathetic account of, quote, anger and mourning on the American right, and in many other sources. But there's a more general cultural phenomenon at work, I believe, of which this is just a specific manifestation, which we might characterize in terms of negative group identity formation. There's a natural human tendency, perhaps rooted in our evolutionary history, that's Franz de Waal's suggestion, to define ourselves in part through our opposition to the other. We don't need to go so far as Carl Schmitt, who took enmity to be the attitude that's constitutive of political membership in the first place. I hope we don't have to go that far, because that's a kind of alarming vision. It suffices that there's a deep proclivity to understand ourselves in these terms. When enmity connects to identity, however, it becomes an especially potent force, and it's one that's surely at work in communities that seem to have sorted themselves into mutually antagonistic tribes, as we tend to refer to them. The resentment of the rural populations who take themselves to have been left behind in contemporary liberal societies is an instance of this tendency, but it can be seen elsewhere in our social life as well. For instance, in the widespread antagonism toward refugee populations in many affluent communities in Europe and North America. That surely is not about envy. Also in the bitter factionalism of left-wing politics in San Francisco, to take just a local example, which seemed to pit liberals against self-styled progressives on issues that, such as housing, schools, and crime. If these observations are on the right track, then many citizens in contemporary democracies will be subject to antagonisms that are bound up with their sense of identity, and that are also evaluatively inscrutable. Their enmity, after all, is not so much a response to a specific incident or set of circumstances as a marker and condition of group membership. We have in this situation another instance of the kind of emotional intelligibility deficit that was the driving force in Nietzsche's slave revolt, at least on my interpretation of it, which can again be understood to constitute a psychic need. In the present case, the emotional problem is not so much the lack of evaluative categories, a new table of values, that could in principle be brought to bear on the objects of antagonism to explain why they might be worthy of contempt. The problem, rather, is that the pervasive antagonism is not really about anything in particular. Its raison d'être is its contribution to group identity formation, which means it is prior to any specific episode that might provide warrant for it. The subject of enmity, in other words, lacks a story about their relation to the object of their hatred that renders that orientation intelligible. This is the psychological predicament that makes a lot of us primed for anger, in my diagnosis. But how exactly does the politics of resentment address this predicament? This was my second question. The primary mechanism, I would suggest, involves narratives of grievance and victimhood. People need to make sense of antagonism that is not really rooted in anything very concrete. So they latch on to narratives that paint the objects of their enmity in moralized terms, as individuals who have wronged or disrespected them in some way. The demagogues of the present moment are masters at generating content of this kind. It's the stock in trade of the Trump rally or the Tucker Carlson segment, as well as the social media algorithm that selects for engagement, and the target audiences eat it up. Thus, coastal elites are constantly depicted as degenerate America haters who despise the cultural signifiers of the heartland, citizens, including their guns, their religion, and their pickup trucks. Economic migrants and refugees get demonized as, quote, illegals who refuse to play by the rules and who deliberately subject the rest of us to a wild spectrum of harms, terrorism, common criminality, exploitation of social programs, disease, etc. San Francisco progressives, meanwhile, depict local YIMBYs as shills for rapacious developers, even when they're proposing to build low-income housing on a Nordstrom valet parking lot, and vice versa, right? There's of course, often a grain of truth to these narratives, but the remarkable thing is that these kernels of truth morph into larger stories of grievance and victimhood that are robustly detached from reality. Facts get totally twisted and distorted as they interact with the process of demagogic panic mongering. It's taken as obvious that Clinton regards all Republicans as deplorables, even though she deployed that expression to distinguish the persuadable Trump supporters from the hardcore who are probably out of reach for her campaign. Roughly, I take it, the group wearing the Trump that bitch t-shirts. Excuse me, but I think that was what was on the t-shirts. An even more striking indication that it's not about truth or plausibility is the prevalence in our culture of grievance narratives that are practically delusional. The most salient and alarming example, of course, is the astonishing QAnon conspiracy theory, which I can hardly get my mind around, but which apparently depicts opponents of Trump as, quote, a cabal of satanic, cannibalistic sexual abusers of children. To quote from the Wikipedia entry. That was as much as I could read about it. It just upsets me. So. My hypothesis is that people would not latch on to stories of this kind unless they satisfied some deep psychic imperative. I mean, it's puzzling, isn't it? On the Nietzschean analysis I've proposed, the problem is that people orient themselves in the larger social world through antagonisms that are bound up with their conception of themselves, but that don't really make sense since they're not concretely about anything in particular. Narratives of grievance and victimhood offer a solution to this predicament, giving subjects a way of understanding the target of their enmity as worthy of this attitude. If the coastal elites look down their noses at you and hold your values and practices in contempt, then you have very good reason to be angry at them. Still more should you be against them if they are satanic cannibals who are trafficking and sexually abusing children. Narratives of this kind make sense of the subject's antagonism toward the other, and in this way provide a remedy for the intelligibility deficit under which they suffer. But it's worth noting that they do not provide a remedy for the antagonism that gives rise to the predicament in the first place. On the contrary, enmity is apt to be intensified when it's refracted through the lens of the narratives that make sense of it, a perverse feedback loop of the kind Nietzsche himself delighted in uncovering. It is common to talk about the contemporary politics of resentment, and at a general level of resolution, that's an apt description of the processes I've been discussing. But it's also potentially misleading. It can suggest that populist movements are responses to resentments that are already present in the target populations in response to genuine grievances they have about the economic and political developments that shape their lives. But the politics of resentment, as I understand it, is not a process that taps into a well of anger on the part of the masses that is already there. Rather, it itself is the thing that makes people angry and gets them riled up, transforming their enmity toward the other, their ressentiment, into an orientation that's recognizable as moralized resentment. Antagonism turns into resentment when it's interpreted as a response to an identifiable wrong, and narratives of grievance are the machinery that affects this transition. They create the resentment that has rightly been thought to dominate populist political movements in the current moment, rather than being a response to a pre-existing and well-defined resentment. And the process of creation is driven by the psychic need people feel to make sense of their prior enmity, of the prior enmity that they have constructed their identity around. Resentment that's generated in this way is clearly seems to me to be a pathology of reaction relative to the ideal of a communicative exchange that's oriented toward repair. Like other forms of reactive blame, it mobilizes the latent social power we have over each other in virtue of our shared vulnerability to the social pressures generated by aversive attitudes. But this deployment of blame is fundamentally narcissistic and therefore virtually impossible to engage. Its meaning and logic lie in the consolations that it affords to the subject rather than in any genuine relational deficiency to which it might be a response. Even if the targets of an attitude like this are disposed to respond to it constructively, it's very hard to know what they're supposed to do about it. The complaints that this anger addresses are not legitimate, and even if there's a grain of truth in them, acknowledgement and apology would only serve as surfaces onto which new manufactured grievances are projected. The most constructive response might be attempt to identify and address significant wrongs that have, in fact, been visited on the subjects who are currently consumed with anger, treating those as the offenses that their resentment is actually about. Many of their communities have, in fact, been ravaged by the tides of modern capitalism, after all, as well as in the United States by an opioid crisis that was engineered by the pharmaceutical industry to generate obscene profits, to take just two of the standard examples that people hit on in this spirit. I'm at a loss myself to think of a better way than this of dealing with the politics of resentment. It at least starts from a place of charity toward the subjects of resentment, and it has the potential to lead to policies that ameliorate genuine injustices and inequalities. It's a somewhat patronizing strategy, however, since it doesn't take at face value the complaints that are actually being expressed by the adult individuals who are riled up against the elites. Nor is it apt to be very effective as a response to that manufactured anger. Insofar as the significance of this attitude lies in its relation to the psychic needs of the subject, it's not really amenable to the usual techniques of relational repair. An effective remedy would need to disarm the processes of negative group identity formation that render people susceptible to narratives of imagined victimhood in the first place. We should treat the politics of grievance not as a normal manifestation of resentment, but as a symptom of a deeper problem that requires a different kind of solution outside the paradigmatic dynamics of reactive blame. So that's the end of the first section. Section two, pathologies of solidarity and reception. In the previous section, I talked about some pathologies of reactive blame on the side of subjects who are the victim of a real or imagined injury. But there are also noteworthy pathologies on the side of other members of the moral community. One of these involves what we might call third-party blame. By this, I mean the kind of indignation that is in principle available to any member of the moral community in response to a moral infraction that has occurred within it. On some approaches, this kind of reaction is, in fact, paradigmatic of blame. Moral obligations are demands that are suited by their nature to be addressed to agents by any representative member of the moral community, acting on the de jure authority they have to speak for all of us. I'm channeling Stephen Darwell here. Addressing demands is, in turn, understood second personally as a matter of holding individuals morally to account for their compliance or lack of compliance with the obligation that is addressed. The paradigmatic reactive expression of blame on this approach is not resentment, but impersonal indignation, the opprobrium that might be directed by any of us against someone who's violated the requirements that bind us all. My relational approach offers a different way of thinking about the paradigmatic case of of reactive blame. The norms around which reactive blame are organized on this approach are directed obligations that specify what one individual owes to another, to others. The flouting of such relational norms has special significance for the parties to whom moral obligations are specifically owed, wronging those parties in particular and giving them a privileged basis for complaint. As we've seen, someone who is in this position has warrant for resentment towards the agent of the infraction. And responding with this refinement of angry disapprobation can be understood as a way of asserting claims on their own behalf. The primary site of reactive blame, as I earlier noted, is thus the nexus between the agent and the individual to whom their directed obligations are owed. The ritualized processes of repair that may be set in motion by the communicative expression of resentment likewise incorporate positional features that are tailored to this relational context. The wrongdoer owes an apology specifically to the victim, for instance. There's scope for third-party blame according to this approach, but as I explained yesterday, it is naturally understood to have a vicarious character. The indignation of the third party is parasitic on the complaint of the individual who has suffered a moral injury or wrong, and it can be understood as a way of asserting the injured person's claim on their behalf. The third party is thus not someone who is authorized to hold individuals accountable as the agent of the moral community at large, nor is the addressing of obligations by third parties the paradigm for a practice of accountability. Reactive blame is embedded within a structure of relational requirements, and that is reflected in our understanding of the primacy of resentment vis-a-vis indignation. A further reflection of this is that indignation does not automatically make sense in response to wrongful conduct, but depends in part on the relation that the third party stands in to the victim of wrongdoing. It also depends maybe on the relation that the a blamer stands in to the agent who is being blamed. This picks up on some issues that Armando raised yesterday in discussion that I hope we'll get back to tomorrow. It's intelligible that any random third party could feel vicarious anger on behalf of the individual who is wronged in a given case, but it's generally fitting for the third party to be indignant only if special relational circumstances obtain. The third party might be a friend or close relative of the victim, or have been authorized by the victim to speak for them. In other situations involving clear and egregious infractions, solidarity with the victim might call for us, all of us in the community, to stand up for the victim, or at least all of us who share local ties with the victim. These same points about the relational structure of accountability can shed light on an interesting class of cases in which blame is subject to moral objections, which we might call pathologies of solidarity. The cases are ones in which third-party blame goes astray on account of the attitude that the subject of blame displays toward the victim of the infraction. A currently popular framing for these problem cases involves the idea of centering. Third-party blame seems problematic when the subject of it centers themselves in their addressing of demands rather than the true victim. This decentering of the true victim can take a variety of forms. A third party might make it about themselves, as we say, by using the occasion of the transgression to flaunt their own upstanding moral character. They self-righteously position themselves at the front of the protest march and take unseemly satisfaction in having an opportunity to demonstrate that they're on the right side of the struggle. These forms of moral grandstanding or virtue signaling are especially prevalent features of reactive discourse on social media platforms. Ray and I were talking about the social media platform, Pylon, which is just a primary example of this, in which, yeah, exhibits the problem. A different case is that in which the third party presumes to speak for the victim, but without bothering to consult them or to listen carefully to their point of view. there is an insidious assumption here that the true victim of injustice is not able to speak for themselves, or that the third party has superior insight into the nature of a wrong that doesn't even affect them directly. Then there are situations in which the third party takes the lead in protesting the infraction in a way that leaves no space for the agency of the victim. The putative ally positions themselves as a kind of savior, defending the rights and claims of individuals who are taken to be incapable of defending themselves. We can think of these situations that center as situations that center the third party's virtue, their voice, and their agency. These are unquestionably pathologies of reactive influence. But what is problematic about them comes into clear focus only against the background of the relational structure of our accountability practices. If third-party indignation is taken to be the paradigmatic expression of moral blame, then each of us should equally be authorized to assert moral demands on behalf of the entire moral community in our guise as its representative. There are no asymmetries of grievance or complaint that are built into our accountability practices at the ground level. But then it becomes obscure why it should be problematic or fraught when unaffected third parties take it upon themselves to address moral demands to wrongdoers on our collective behalf. They're speaking for all of us, after all, not specifically for the parties who have suffered the injury. Granted, it's consistent with this story that our practices of accountability might have developed in ways that incorporate conventions of deference toward those who've been harmed by violations of the requirements that bind us all. But there's nothing in the nature of third-party blame that would make such conventions presumptively reasonable or correct. Things look very different if we accept the relational interpretation of accountability for which I've been advocating in these lectures. According to that approach, moral infractions give rise to privileged grievances on the part of those whom they wrong, which connect to the claims those parties hold against the agent of the wrongful conduct. Third-party blame is possible within this framework, but it's also, as I keep saying, essentially vicarious, the asserting of a claim held by another individual on their behalf. Acting vicariously on another's behalf, however, is a project that's inherently a source of special responsibilities. There is first the question of whether you should be speaking for the injured party in the first place. This might make sense if, for instance, you stand in a special relationship to the victim and they aren't able to speak for themselves, or if they have asked you to step in as an ally in opposing the wrongdoer. But in the absence of such special reasons, it will probably seem presumptuous or meddlesome for you to take a stand on what went on between the agent and their victim. It might not even really be your business. Furthermore, even when there's a reason to assert claims on behalf of the injured party, you'll owe it to the victim to exert such influence as you have in ways that support rather than undermine their own standing and authority. You have to center their voice and their agency in your efforts at solidarity and allyship. And it's definitely not okay to use the occasion to show off about your own superior virtue and moral insight. Failure to live up to these standards will generally reflect a lack of regard for the individual you are asserting claims on behalf of, something that gives them a new basis for resenting you. Finally, there are pathologies on the side of the targets of reactive blame, the putative wrongdoers at whom exertions of social influence are directed. I've suggested that we might think about these exertions in terms of interpersonal power. But power of this kind, as an essentially social phenomenon, is to some extent also socially constructed. It's present only to the extent its target registers the attitudes that it mobilizes and experiences them as aversive. In the first lecture, I suggested that we have some natural tendencies to respond to anger in these ways, but I also noted that there are natural exceptions, including the kind of narcissist who welcomes the attention of others however it is valenced and expressed. But even if one's not a narcissist of this kind, one's susceptibility to the angry disapprobation of others might be attenuated by its interaction with background inequalities of resources and opportunities. Someone with a sufficiently vast fortune might be able to retreat into a private refuge, into which expressions of reactive blame barely penetrate, which would perhaps provide some degree of immunity from their influence. That seems kind of plausible to me, but then I immediately think of Elon Musk, who seems to have, despite vast resources, a very thin skin in some way. But anyway, some rich people might be able to avail themselves of this resource. It's often observed that there are different culturally inflected scripts for making sense of emotions, and that these scripts can shape the attitudes themselves, making of them one thing rather than another. These scripts affect how the subjects of reactive attitudes in a cultural formation tend to understand them, but they also affect how they are interpreted by other individuals, including those who are their proper targets. And it's noteworthy that some of the scripts that take hold, especially under conditions of oppression and injustice, reinforce social inequalities in troubling ways. Two familiar examples of this phenomenon are the scripts that presumptively deny the legitimacy of reactive anger when its subject is a black man or a woman. Thus, there's the interpretive lens that leads people to see the anger of black men as a disruptive and essentially irrational interpersonal force, rather than as a permissible way of addressing complaints to agents who have engaged in wrongful conduct. The prevalence of this interpretive script provides the background to the recurrent Comedy Central skits in which Keegan-Michael Key played the role of Luther, President Obama's anger translator. The obvious premise in these scenes is that Obama, as a black American male, is not really allowed to call on the resources of reactive blame in response to ordinary injustices and infractions, but can only allude to them in language that is buttoned up and affectless. Hence the need for a translator of the anger that Obama himself is unable to express. Though it's a further comic theme that Luther's vicarious performance of presidential anger is florid and out of control, which draws on the same script that forces Obama to repress his anger in the first place. Anger is represented as a source of social power in this interpretive framework, but treated as untethered from the kinds of reasoned complaints that might be acknowledged to be a basis for discursive exchange. The result of this script is to write black males out of the shared story of who is entitled to assert moral claims on their own behalf, interpersonally. This is an egregious recognitional failure in itself, and one that serves to perpetuate existing injustices and to prevent the victims of them from deploying the most basic interpersonal mechanism available to us for identifying moral injuries and insisting that they be dealt with. There's a similar entrenched script for interpreting the reactive attitudes of women, that which dismisses their anger as a symptom of hysteria. This interpretive lens is similar in its operations to the script for black male anger. The reactive attitudes of women are recognized to be potentially forms of power or social leverage, but exertions of this power are taken to operate outside the parameters of rational intelligibility. They are read as ungovernable forces to be managed clinically, but not as sincere communicative gambits that might be engaged with on their own terms. Women to whom this script is applied are not really treated as autonomous members of the moral community, individuals with claims against the rest of us that they're authorized to address in their own person. The prevalence of scripts of this kind amounts to a pathology of reception within our accountability practices. It's a way of denying the equal standing of historically vulnerable and oppressed members of the moral community. In failing to register their reactive blame as legitimate, we in effect denigrate the dignity of women and black men. They're debarred from entering the space of social relations defined by the reactive attitudes, insofar as the targets of those attitudes don't respond within the Straussonian participant stance, but deal with these attitudes objectively as pressures to be managed and contained. This is clearly problematic, judged by reference to our ideal of a communicative exchange that is oriented towards repair. There's no prospect of constructive communicative engagement if reactive blame is not regarded as a potentially legitimate move in the first place. And the exclusion of historically disadvantaged populations from these mechanisms of repair obviously and crassly serves to perpetuate oppression. What would an improved set of practices of reception look like? In one way, I think it would exhibit the opposite polarity to that which is latent in the exclusionary scripts I've been discussing. Those scripts write off the reactive blame of members of salient disadvantaged groups as presumptively illegitimate. A better approach would clearly be to presume that the complaints of vulnerable individuals are plausible, even when it may initially be obscure to their target what exactly they are about. The experience of structural disadvantage, after all, brings with it epistemic resources that may not be available to more privileged individuals. And against this background, it's important to listen carefully to the testimony that's expressed through reactive complaint and to do our best to engage with it on its own terms. The default receptive stance, in other words, should be a willingness to enter into the kind of conversational exchange with the angry subject that's oriented towards understanding and acknowledgement and repair. But there's a different, if less common, pathology in this general vicinity, which is to cede automatic authority to the members of disadvantaged communities whenever they deploy reactive resources to voice interpersonal complaints. Those of us who operate in a space of privilege should by all means give vulnerable parties the benefit of the doubt when complaints are addressed to us and do our best to make sense of them as they are presented. But nobody is an unfailing advocate on their own behalf, and it's possible for any of us to fall short in the challenging task of locating the lines in our social relations that are not to be crossed. We encountered this already in discussing the politics of grievance, where angry complaints are pressed often by individuals who have, in fact, suffered hardship and disadvantage that simply don't make much sense at the end of the day. In other cases, the complaint that is pressed by a vulnerable person might be coherent and perhaps even have some initial plausibility without standing up to sympathetic scrutiny when everything is taken into account. The Muslim students at Hamline University might sincerely have thought they were victims of Islamophobia when an instructor, Erica Lopez Prater, showed a respectful image of the Prophet in an art history class. But it was clearly wrong for the college administration to defer unthinkingly to their point of view without taking into consideration the conscientious efforts that Prater, herself a somewhat vulnerable as a person on a contingent teaching contract, had made to contextualize the image and to protect students who might take offense at it from exposure. What is called for in cases of this kind is a conversation that opens into the kind of delicate co-deliberation whereby the interests of different parties are sympathetically taken into account in a good faith effort to identify principles of conduct acceptable to all. This is, to my mind, a plausible generic way of characterizing the project of moral deliberation as a kind of co-deliberation, and it faces many challenges in practice. The objections that vulnerable individuals have to prospective policies and principles need to be registered and understood and taken seriously within this reasoning, but as important starting points for co-deliberation rather than as trump cards that automatically bring moral reasoning to an end. Okay, that's the end of the second section. Section three, social power in interpersonal recognition. The social frictions inherent in reactive blame impede normal interpersonal relations coming between the subject and their target until the infractions that occasioned it are dealt with. The constructive response to this, I've suggested, is the kind of communicative exchange that's continuous with moral co-deliberation, oriented toward understanding and, if necessary, acknowledgement and repair. But the same attitudes that potentially initiate a constructive process of this kind sometimes stand in the way of its being realized. This is a still different pathology of reactive anger, one that is interactive rather than exclusively on the side of either the subject or the target. The specific phenomenon I have in mind here is that whereby angry protest is met with a response that is equally angry and unyielding. I suggested in the first lecture that there's something confrontational about the action tendencies characteristic of the reactive attitudes. They incline the subject to stand up to the target, protesting the way the subject has been treated by the target and insisting that the infraction be dealt with. But confrontations sometimes become entrenched, especially when the target of reactive blame gets defensive. Under these circumstances, anger can beget anger in a ratchet that never progresses to the stage of co-deliberation or acknowledgement and repair. Instead, each side sinks deeper into their sense of grievance and complaint, making uncompromising demands of the other that only become more adamant when they are met with defiance. This is, of course, a potentially dangerous dynamic that can spiral completely out of control, and there's nothing valuable about it that I can discern. Actually, a counterexample may be that there's a Netflix series called what's called Beef, which is, you know, that what's valuable about it is that's kind of a, not a bad, I haven't watched at all, but it seems to be a premised, a comical version of this kind of ratchet situation. And so maybe there's some value in the situation that it gives rise to effective comedy, but that's a stretch. If a practice of accountability relations is to play a constructive role in the life of a moral community, then the propensity to reactive blame will need to be married to techniques that generally prevent this kind of defensive ratchet from getting started. What's called for is vigilant deployment of our powers of managerial control over our attitudes in the service of a specifically moral objective. As subjects of the reactive attitudes, we have obligations to ensure that the attitudinal power we have over others is not used to frivolous, malevolent, or merely narcissistic ends. As allies, we need to be mindful of the interests of those on whose behalf we address moral demands and find ways of standing by them that honor their voice and their agency. And as targets of reactive blame, we have to acknowledge the entitlement of everyone to participate as equals in the system of accountability and listen sympathetically to their complaints. To respond to anger automatically with defensive counter-anger reflects a ridiculous presumption of infallibility and a refusal to accept the possibility that criticism might sometimes be warranted. Of course, if everyone were living up to their moral obligations, then reactive blame would never be called for in the first place. It's inherently an instrument of non-ideal response. If you're interacting with people who've not only acted wrongfully, but who are also disinclined to respond constructively to blame, that will raise interesting questions about how best to manage your warranted reactions to their conduct. If the communicative expression of reactive blame would only provoke angry denial and defensive recrimination, there may be good strategic and prudential reasons for charting a different path through the situation. I think this is the trajectory of that recent film and novel, Women Talking, where the victimized women end up taking the leave option, and that seems like a reasonable response, given that anger would just be met with implacable denial. In other cases, especially ones that involve structural injustice and oppression, it may make sense to band together with other victims and allies to protest the situation with persistence and communal force. These political contexts are ones in which the power dimension of reactive blame is particularly significant. It can be a tool to be deployed by individuals whose social situation deprives them of access to other levers of influence. And this is a position that's influentially and effectively been defended recently by Amya Srinivasan and Mia Shacheri, amongst others. The mobilization of reactive blame in political protest is a way of bringing social pressure to bear on those who are morally recalcitrant. It creates new reasons grounded in the aversive quality of opprobrium and is forceful expression for political actors who have proven themselves unresponsive to the moral considerations that tell against existing It creates new reasons for political actors who've proven themselves unresponsive to the moral considerations that tell against existing social arrangements. To exercise social power in this way, to influence morally recalcitrant agents, seems a defensible technique of non-ideal politics. But are exertions of the social power latent in reactive blame defensible outside of this special context? I've suggested that reactive blame has a potentially constructive role to play within a communicative, interpersonal process that is oriented toward repair. This mechanism, however, relies on the social power we have over each other in virtue of our aversion to the reactive attitudes of our fellows. By exerting this power, we give others reasons for action that they would not otherwise have. And the understandable concern is that these are reasons of the wrong kind to figure centrally in a set of moral practices. We should want people to comply with the requirements that they owe to us out of a concern for our interests and claims, not because of their desire to avoid our opprobrium. A philosophical account of blame that seems vulnerable to this objection is Bernard Williams's influential proleptic interpretation. According to this really fascinating account, blame often incorporates a presumption that's literally false. We treat people who may not have had reasons to care about the moral standards that they flout as if they were subject to such reasons when we apply the pressures of blame. This practice has the interesting feature, however, that it reliably makes true the false assumption that it begins from. Blame taps into a concern that the target has to be respected by people they respect, making clear to them that their immoral conduct will attract the subject's opprobrium. This process gives the target of blame reason to comply with the moral standards that they didn't antecedently have through deployment of the aversive social pressures I have been thematizing in these lectures. Now, Williams himself was skeptical about the idea that the standards of interpersonal morality are ones that everyone has reason to care about. Creating what he called internal reasons through the deployment of social power is perhaps a reasonable function for a system of accountability to realize under this assumption. It's better to give people bad reasons to do the right thing than to leave them without any reason at all for so acting. But the assumption is not part of the relational account of morality that I have proposed as a framework for understanding our accountability practices. The norms that define what we owe to each other as moral persons represent obligations that everyone has presumptively decisive reason to comply with. It's not the role of blame to supplant those obligations with reasons that are created through the social power we have over each other. What work is done, then, by the attitudinal pressures that are brought to bear on agents through exertions of reactive blame? Reactive blame is a response to apparent violations of moral demands, cases in which the target of blame has already flouted relational requirements. The social pressures that we bring to bear in this context do indeed create new reasons, but they operate primarily to incentivize the target to re-engage with the reasons that their wrongful conduct disregarded in the first place. By impeding normal interactions between the parties, reactive blame sends the message that the rift in the relationship needs to be dealt with and that things cannot move forward unless and until that happens. This is a legitimate role for social power to play and one that presupposes rather than supplants the relational considerations that give agents their primary reasons for staying on the right side of the moral lines. Thank you very much.
I have a question about 2A in your outline here on third-party blame and the pathologies of solidarity and reception. And I was wondering how you might make sense of, John Brown, for instance, at Harper's Ferry or something. That's me, supposing that he had himself been a victim of Southern slave owners. And didn't really have significant ties to the slave community he was hoping would rise up and revolt by attacking the depot there. So I feel like we can make sense of that in some way, but I'm curious how you would make sense of our, you know, of his reactive blame here being something that, is this something that, is he, you know, would be understood still in some sort of baroque way, or is this going to fall in kind of a pathological category if it wasn't a significant tie to the victim? Just curious how you...
Yeah, that's a great question, and that's a great example to think about. I think that is one of the cases where I was thinking that, there might be special relational elements in that present in this case, where we've got an incredibly egregious systemic injustice being committed in our name, tolerated by our political institutions, under those conditions, it seems like we might owe a duty of solidarity to the victims, to stand by them in some way in protest against the injustice. This is something even Scanlon says about cases, though it gets a different inflection in his account. The idea is in this case is maybe not necessarily that there's a antecedent special relation to the particular victims. They're not members of our family necessarily, but they might just be members of our community who suffered a particularly grave injustice. And I think it makes sense to me to think that under circumstances like that, we might owe them a duty of solidarity to stand with them in protest against what's going on. Now, whether the way John Brown was doing that was really, totally sensitive to the other, obligations he might have owed to the individual he was trying to stand in solidarity with is a further question. It seemed it attracted a lot of attention, I think. I don't know whether it was constructive. I'm not enough of a historian to know whether it was a constructive moment in the process of that eventually led to emancipation or not. It certainly led to a lot of death at the site, I believe. And so those are further questions we'd have to ask, what the effective way is to stand in solidarity with the victims in a case like this. But I'm open to the idea that when an injustice is particularly grave and when it affects members of your own political community, that that's enough to make intelligible the idea that we have a special relationship that to join in protest against the injustice. In this case, I'm imagining John Brown is an American citizen, and so he's protesting an injustice that's happening in his own political community. There could be even cases where imagine a genocidal, we were for some reason talking about Paul, well, for various reasons, good reasons, talking about Pol Pot yesterday, but where you get a egregious kind of genocidal injustice, there might be something to be said for the idea that everyone owes a duty of solidarity to the victims, to stand up for them however they can, and not everyone will be positioned to do that very effectively. I'd be open to those kinds of special circumstances. But, I think the relevant idea would be they'll be triggered in cases where the infraction is particularly egregious. But even there, what you're protesting is really the injustice done to the victims. You're not just asserting claims as a representative member of the moral community. If that's where... what it was about, my point is, that should never be presumptively problematic. We're all authorized to do that, to make a citizen's arrest on Darwell's account.
Thank you so much for the talk. I'm TJ. I had a couple of related questions. The first question was about what you mentioned about the reverse polarity of how, under 2C, practice or reception exhibit the reverse polarity of presuming that the complaints of the marginalized are legitimate. And I was wondering if you think that there's a similar kind of presumption that maybe we should have before we express our own emotions of reactive blame. in the sense that you might think, you know, the presumption should be maybe this person didn't realize that they have injured me in some way, or didn't mean to, or something like that, and that therefore before I express that, I should have that kind of presumption, and therefore maybe tone down my initial kind of reaction in terms of the outburst of blame. That's the first part. And so on a related, in a related sense, the next question has to do with then the next point on in number three, which talks about how when the victims of injustice confront agents who are recalcitrant and dangerous, there may actually be a strategic or potential case for downplaying their anger. And so when we put these two things together, it seems like I find myself in a little bit of a bind, because it seems like if the other person actually cares about our relationship and this kind of, and cares about these moral requirements that that relationship imposes on them, then it doesn't seem like I need to react in a very kind of angry and blaming way, because just, you know, if I just point out a nice way, hey, look, you and throw on my toes or something, they would care about it and make amends. On the other hand, if they're the kind of person that doesn't really even care about the relationship, then it seems like expressing my reactive blame doesn't really solve the situation, makes them defensive, and you know, it may be even dangerous for me, as you point out here. And so it's like the people who would respond to reactive blame are people whom I don't need to respond to in a blaming way, and the people who don't care about me and that I really want to blame, like it seems like it's not really going to have effect on them. So it seems like I'm in a bit of a bind on this one day.
Yeah, TJ, those are great questions. And, you know, they hit a nerve, because I sometimes worry in this, as I talk about this material, I'm supposed to be doing in these talks is like, this is on behalf of a general defense of reactive blame, but one that kind of takes seriously some of the things that people have worried about in the, it's striking how many philosophical traditions, venerable traditions, converge in telling us to get over anger. And, you know, Stoicism, utilitarianism, Martha Nussbaum, Confucians, Buddhists, it's New Agers. I mean, so I'm trying to push back against that general tradition and make a case for the legitimacy of reactive blame as an important part of our moral practices, but in a way that is sensitive to what makes it morally fraught, and to some of the potential pathologies that I think are genuinely associated with it. But coming back to hitting a nerve, my worry is that, you know, once one's done full justice to all the potential forms of pathologies and the need to manage it elaborately, there's not a whole lot of role left for it at the end of the day. So, I'm troubled by, maybe I shouldn't be troubled by that. Maybe that's my own way of getting to this conclusion at the end of the day. But it is a kind of residual worry I have. I mean, I do think that there's, I think your first point is perfectly well taken, and I was referring to practices of managing reactive blame to ensure that these pathologies don't get a grip in the first place. And I think it's kind of a good idea to operate kind of in a space of charity where you give people the benefit of the doubt for the most part, rather than just assuming that they were acting with an intention to harm you or cause you injury or something like that. Having said that, those charitable strategies only get you so far, and there are cases where people are genuinely at least negligent or reckless, or have acted to belittle you or have betrayed a promise. Or I go back to Scanlon's example, said something that you told them in confidence to promote ridicule. I mean, those are genuine infractions within a relational context. The suggestion was if we're the victims of such an infraction, the other party is disposed to the constructive process of communicative exchange I was pointing towards, then we really shouldn't need anger anyway. All we need to do is calmly, and maybe in our Obama voice, point in the direction of where the problem might not potentially lie, and they'll just charitably be inclined to deal with it constructively and so on. And you know, there are certainly cases where that that can happen. But note that the person we're dealing with, who cares about the relationship, is the very person who did the infraction in the first place. I mean, you could, if they were really concerned about our interests, they would have treated us decently to begin with, right? So it seems to me, when you think about that, you know, there is some kind of intermediate space within an ongoing valuable relationship where, you know, people let each other down in ways and need a little confrontation to be made aware that it's a significant thing. And those are the kind of, and I think, you know, that's the kind of familiar context where I think blame is a kind of reactive blame is pretty common. It's like, you know, I think it comes up in intimate contexts, but in this kind of way, when one's acted with a lack of sufficient consideration, the other party's kind of pissed off about that. The parties are, you know, they don't have to go into an elaborate communicative spiel. You know, I can come home and probably be immediately aware that I've committed an infraction from the way my partner is emptying the dishwasher or something. You know, it's just in the air in some sense. But I think, you know, it can be useful in that context. And so I guess that's one place where I think it's got a particularly constructive role to play. And then the other is I come back to the first question from Julian about egregious injustice and duties of solidarity and allyship and so on. I think it's important there. Thanks.
I just wanted a brief clarificatory question on what exactly is meant by managerial agency. Just elaborate on that.
Okay, yeah, good. Yeah, I guess what I was thinking of as, I was thinking that, and this goes back to yesterday's lecture, I was thinking that, you know, if these reactive attitudes are aversive in the ways I've been characterizing, you know, then people don't like to be subject to them anyway, so they're potential sources of influence. And I was thinking we get social power out of influence when it's inflected through our agency. And I was thinking there are two ways in which agency can, you know, can attenuate or intensify the influence of these negative reactive attitudes. One is expressively. There's expressive agency where we're feeling pissed off at someone, and we give voice to it. That's something we're doing with a communicative aim and purpose, right? So that's expressive agency. And I was thinking there's a second kind of agency, which is managerial, where the note of agency is, you know, it's we're doing something with our reactive attitude. We're managing it in a certain way. We can cultivate anger. We can accede to it. The language that we use to talk about this is kind of shot through with agency, right? We cultivate it. We can accede to it. We can deploy it. I mean, I think the choleric boss I was referring to is someone who's managing their anger. Partly it's expressive, but partly they're performing it in a way that kind of intensifies it and treats it as significant in the interpersonal context. And that too is a way of kind of intensifying or attenuating anger. The attenuation side of it might be, you know, we try to overcome it. We try to and I was saying yesterday, this is kind of like the space of forgiveness on my way of thinking about this. To forgive someone is to resolve to, and we can't always put this off, but we resolve to treat it as interpersonally insignificant in the context of a relationship. Or to overcome it altogether. And that too is a way of managing the anger that's there. So I guess, does that make sense? That's what I was thinking. Yeah.
Thank you. I want to, this time I'll have one example. And I'm trying to show a case.
I loved all the examples yesterday.
And Michael got overboard.
Yeah.
Where there's no wrong subject, or at least where you're not the wrong subject, where there's no vicariousness, which I think is one.
There's not the
vicariousness.
Oh, yeah.
Not vicarious thing. And something that is indignation rather than envy. So I'm thinking of, resentment. So imagine academic resentment of the following kind. you are a distinguished professor, I'm a postdoc, hypothetically. And then from there, now let's change reality a little bit. Let's say that you never published anything. And then I'm really resentful because I think that you don't deserve it. And let's say I think I don't deserve it either. And my resentment gets even worse because I know you're really smart and you're just wasting all your intelligence, like tap dancing around or something like that. And I just feel like horrible academic resentment because you're the distinguished professor at Berkeley. So I'm trying to see if you could say that these two aspects of it, one that you have a position that you don't deserve, and the second part that you have an ability that you didn't induce, that those two things could be resentment, not just, and not the carrier's resentment, and not envy.
Yeah, good. It's another very rich example with a lot going on in it. I think you're not going to like my response, but...
It's all the carriers.
But I hope you don't hate me for it or resent me too much. But I, you know, naturally, I'm going to read some more relational elements into it. And so, one way of thinking about the case that you were talking about might be one where I'm picking up, especially in the second element you attributed to the person in my position, genuine ability that they're not really using. And we're in the same kind of intellectual community or something like that. We both value tremendously philosophical research and care about it and are invested in it doing well and so on. I can see a foothold for something like resentment on your part in that situation. But here comes the relational interpretation of the background. Situation. It seems like it makes sense against the context, or in a context where you think that someone who's unusually talented, who has a very influential and position that gives them great opportunities to pursue, to exercise their talents and abilities to pursue the activity at a high level, you might think that they kind of owe it to all of us in the philosophy community to take advantage of their opportunities and make use of their talents. And insofar as we all are invested in the flourishing of philosophy, it seems like there's space. I can see space for thinking that, you know, this is something I owe to everyone in my community in virtue of both having the talent that you described and the position that gives me opportunities to deploy it effectively in ways that will benefit something that we all care about. I think in that kind of context, yeah, I think resentment might make sense, and the person who's failed to take advantage of their opportunities in the way you were describing, you know, has let everyone down. He's wronged them by not living up to what he owes to them all in virtue of his privileged position and opportunities. I think that's going to be too moralized for you, and I'm sure we're going to come back and continue discussing this tomorrow, but that would be an initial stab at that interesting case.
So this is kind of a follow-up to TJ. Also about Camilla. It seems third-party blame provides a way out of the kind of dilemma that TJ gave us, where either my anger is unnecessary because you already care about my interests, and it's useless because you don't care about my anger either.
Yeah.
But if you have sort of person A, you care about person A's opinion, you have person B wrong, the person A can use third-party blame to kind of ratchet you up to caring about person B. So this is kind of a maybe general reason in favor of third-party blame is that it can be better by interests that you would otherwise have no way into.
Good. Yeah, I like that. I think that's good. I overlooked that, but that would be a useful resource. I mean, it actually very much draws on this Williams idea of you want to be respected by people you respect, and so you're talking about a wrongdoer who doesn't respect the victim but does respect some third party, and that might actually be a relational thing that gives them a different kind of special reason for standing by them as an ally. So there's a lot more here that needs to be said. But I think that will fit into actually. I think that's grist for my mill in a way I might be able to make use of. And it's a really nice point. So I appreciate it, Ray. Thanks.
Thank you so much for joining me.
Yeah, thank you all very much.